Welcome to Taranaki Foodies, the tastiest food show on the Most FM. Here we talk about food, garden, hospitality in our beautiful Taranaki. And of course, music. We are recording our show live in Facebook group page. Look for Taranaki Foodies. Join in if you like to peek behind the scenes. My co-host today is Jeff Poole.
Hello!
He's a reality TV star from New Zealand Great Bake Off, mentor, author, and musician. And today's cameraman is Nathan Griffith. And he's a foodie and all-rounder good man.
Although you couldn't tell, I'm looking at him. I think we need to fatten him up a little bit.
Well, that's why he's involved in the Taranaki Foodies. So our guests today, amazing team of Texas barbecue foods, Ash and Jerynn Peters. Welcome.
Welcome, thank you.
Hi, good afternoon.
Hello, Taranaki.
Hi, so first of all, we will listen to the music. Jeff, can you tell us a few words about this music? Do you know something?
We've got some great music from the 80s. Fleetwood Mac. Come on, bring it on.
So this thing is off, so this red, it means that your microphones are not switched on. But the video is going on, so don't say anything you don't want, you'll regret afterwards. So thank you guys for coming. This was so nice to meet you at the Chamber of Commerce event. And I think Jeff saw you there as well, because yeah. Jeff mentored a group of young people. Was it Bubble Tea?
Yeah.
Petit Cha. How did they do? I know that they didn't win, right? Or did they win?
I don't know yet. I haven't heard. I didn't think they'd made it.
Okay. All right. So this is a young producers, young children who decided to make a company, and this is pretty amazing. Yeah. So food industry is very vibrant in Taranaki, and there are so many things happening all the time.
Yeah, this Taranaki is definitely a bit of a food bowl. It's amazing some of the products that are made here and actually have good quality products there.
Yes,
and myself pancakes all around the world.
And the regulations here are so strict, so people have lots of trust in how we produce, how we pack, how we sell, and all the stuff in between.
Well, the rules around manufacturing in New Zealand are very tight, and so they should be. You know, food safety is really, really important, and I think our regulations are very good, but they're the protection.
Absolutely. Totally agree. And I think this is the way to go, because we are kind of huge on what we are doing, and we do it properly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. I'll ask you why you choose this music after the break, and I hope Jerynn you can say a few words about it too. Do you like Fleetwood Mac?
No.
Here we go. This sounds like an interesting story to come.
She's got the last song that we chose.
All right.
I don't think I know the last song. 1,000 Edits.
Oh, this is Christina Perry. It's from the series about the Twilight, I think.
Twilight. Oh, I know one. Yeah.
And also, it was kind of replayed. There's a number of different replays, like covers from different artists.
Yes. Different versions,
absolutely, yeah. This is quite an easy listening. Do you listen to the music when you cook at home? Do you cook at home for the
time? Yeah, I do. I love cooking.
What's your favorite food?
I'm Asian, so Asian food.
Yeah. How Asian you are.
100%. I love noodles. Right. I love stir fries. Yeah. His favorite is casserole with peanut sauce.
Yeah, seasick.
It's roasted pork, and then you saute it with lots of garlic and onion.
Oh yum! Oh my god!
And chili. She gets upset at me because she'll have the seasick with rice and that, and I'll get a piece of bread and butter, and I'll put the seasick on the bread, and that's the sandwich. It's so yummy.
I'm half Asian, my dad is Korean, and Jeff, I think, I don't know, mentally he's Asian, because he likes to fuse lots of different foods.
And I'm a Filipino, so we love to entertain and we love to cook.
Awesome, welcome back to the studio of the Most FM. We just listened of Fleetwood Mac everywhere. So, can you please tell us, why did you choose this piece of music?
It's a good bit of classic music, you know. It's just classical. It's got a lovely beat and it's really easy to listen to.
It's not Jackson?
No.
Jerynn, do you like this type of music?
It's not my favorite, but I don't mind listening to it.
That's the answer of a good woman who doesn't want to start a scandal on the radio station.
Come on, everybody likes 80s music.
Yes,
even
yes.
My teenage
yes,
kids do.
Me too.
I don't. Sorry, don't beat me.
Oh, my son, he listens to some 80s music and says, oh, wow, Dad, you know, did you hear that song? And I said, should I listen to that, you know, 30 years ago.
So companies launch their start with red carpet, celebrity guests, some very, very up-brand packages for the attendees. Your company started with a donation of meat to those who can't afford meat. How did this happen? Tell us about it.
We wanted to put something back into the community. You know, there's some people out there that are really, really struggling. We've done a number of cooks of different, the product using different flavour profiles. And some of them met our profiles, some of them didn't. And we didn't want to see any of what we cooked went to waste. We wanted to see it go to a good home and have good use. So we donated, I think it was somewhere in the vicinity of 1,100 kilos of cooked product.
Pork and
to
beef.
To local charities to feed some families that are struggling.
That's amazing. 11,000 kilos.
1,100
kilos. This is massive. It's like several herds of cows.
it's a lot of meat, but you know, why waste it? There was nothing wrong with it. It was perfectly good. It didn't meet our flavour profile as in the spices we'd used as we were sort of dialing in on out the product that we want.
So this was part of your product development, was it?
Yes.
Yes.
So by October last year, your pork and beef had won a prize at the Inspire Artisan Awards. And by November, Texas Barbecue Foods was in supermarkets around the whole North Island. Do you have a big team? How did you pull it through?
We haven't got a very big team. There's basically my wife, Jerynn, who's here with me, and my sister-in-law, Shallow, and myself. They're the core of our team. We have 6 or 7 casuals that come in and help us when we're producing.
And Shallow's husband.
And Shallow's husband, you can't forget Al. And so we are the base team. And for getting around New Zealand, we had some help with the supermarkets. You know, we've got to say thank you to Foodstuffs and Kiantian for arranging our products and bringing it to marketplace. And we've had some help through a good PR team based in Auckland.
And when we were starting, we also have lots of friends who helped us.
Oh, wow.
When we were cooking, when we were packing, when we were still dialing what packaging are we going to use or how much, they're a big help.
Yeah, this whole business has been quite a challenge. You know, we've gone from what started off as a hobby of cooking 1 or 2 pieces of meat at a time to cooking, 200, 300, and 400 pieces of meat at a time. And the learning to go from 1 or 2 to 300 at a time has been huge, and we couldn't have done that without the help and support of our friends to actually learn those processes and really perfect them to make it work.
So how long has this process taken?
I first started doing this back in 2008, and it's been a learning curve ever since.
Wow, so basically your business is national already, and it's only a family business, so only family members are working for you. And I've noticed that your family is multicultural, right? Do you experience any multicultural difficulties in the business?
Probably communication. We all got different ways of describing things. You know, we use different phrases, like some of the Kiwi slang that I grew up with and use on a daily basis. You know, during sometimes doesn't understand what that slang means, and vice versa.
Yeah.
Wait until some young people will start using their slang. They'll say something, oh, that's sick, and that actually means that it's really good meat.
Yeah,
it is.
So, why Texas in New Zealand? Tell us. Did you travel to US? Was it connected to cooking at all?
I've spent a lot of time working in Houston, Texas with the oil industry. That's my background. And when I first went over there, I tried Texas barbecue for the first time, and I went, wow, what have I been missing all my life? You know, this is just beautiful. This is nothing like the Texas barbecue or barbecue that's been sold or promoted in New Zealand.
Absolutely. And we had this discussion before that in Eastern Europe, where I originally came from, cured meats and smoked meats and barbecue, which we call shashlik, is very, very popular. And there are so many different ways to do it. There is a cold way to do it, hot way to do it. There is a marinade before, or just basically so many things. How does it relate to the Texas style?
Well, Texas barbecue was actually the Czech and German immigrants that come to North America. They migrated in, they come and hop off the boat at New York. They got pushed out of New York by the Irish and the Italians, which had sort of taken over the city, and they migrated south as far as they could go until they hit the Gulf of Mexico. And they brought with them all their smoking and cooking traditions from Europe. So on market days, when all the cattle would be driven to market and the farmers would bring all their produce in, a lot of these immigrants would come into town and they would cook up their meat and smoke their meat in their old traditions, and sell it to all the buyers and sellers that had come to the market day. And this is where it evolved from. And they used local ingredients that was available to them. So that's where some of the chilies and the other spices come into play, because that was locally available. The hardwood like mesquite and some of the post oaks and that was what was available to them. So they used what was available to cook their food.
It's amazing. We are so global. All the cultures are mixed up. We are experiencing such a great fusion of food. And here, in a small Taranaki, we are having food from all over the world.
Sorry, do you use mesquite, or what do you use to smoke
with? We use mesquite. We use that for quite a range of reasons. One, I love the wood. It's not my favourite wood. My favourite is a wood called post oak, but I just can't get my hands on it. But the mesquite is a very nice wood. It would be my second favourite. It leaves a lovely, sweet, mellow finish. It leaves no aftertaste in your mouth. It's just a lovely smoke. And when you've finished a mouthful of food, you don't get that lingering aftertaste like you can, say, out of minute.
You need to see if you can organise to get some from Outback Australia. It's a pest weed out there, so they try to get rid of it all.
Really? Oh, wow.
It should be.
Somewhere it's valuable. Somewhere it's a pest. It's pretty amazing. So what was your favourite dish when you were children?
Oh, there was probably a couple. It'd be my mum's steamed pudding. That would have to be one. And minced peas and potatoes, of all things. When I was a kid, I just loved minced peas and potatoes.
Jerynn, what about you?
Adobo. It's a Filipino dish.
Pork adobo.
With vinegar, soy sauce, garlic, and onion. And Bailey.
I know the guy here who is a Filipino cook. He owns this Fusion Mobile Kitchen.
Yep, I know him.
He cooks amazing adobo.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm promoting you. But he's just in general a very good cook. He's from Auckland, and
he's a chef.
Yeah, he worked with celebrities, and his food truck is basically like a high end food in a truck.
Yes.
Mm. So amazing. So I guess no vegetarians in your family.
Well, let's put it this way. I consider myself a vegetarian because I eat recycled vegetables. Because all our beef eats grass. So.
This particular time of this, how society develops, there are a lot of people who follow certain food paths, like keto dieting or some other things. How do you cater for this?
Well, our products is quite ideally suited to a lot of these high protein style diets and the keto diets. We've got no additives and no preservatives or any of that in our
all natural
products.
Oh wow!
And that's really important to us, because I love it so much. I don't want to be eating.
And sugar content is very, very little.
How do you make it slightly sweet? Because I bought it in the supermarket before. It has a slightly sweet taste. How did you get it?
It's the natural sugars in the meat, and by the slow cooking process, the natural sugars come out. Mm. We actually use half a gram of sugar per kg of meat. And everyone goes, well, why so little, but why the sugar at all? And quite simply, we use the sugar as an adhesive to hold the peppers on the meat. So there's three different types of pepper we use, and when we put the pepper on, it wants to fall off. So by having just the absolute minute amount of sugar that hits the meat and dissolves and holds the pepper there.
Wow.
And as the meat goes through the cook process, the meat hits a point that they call a straw, where it starts to sweat. And when it hits that point in the cooking smoking process, any of that minute amount of sugar on the surface is actually expelled and ends up in drip trays at the bottom. Mm. So the sweetness is purely
from the meat,
from the natural sugars in the meat.
How did you learn that?
reading, Googling, and I actually had some quite old Texans that taught me a lot about how to do this and some of the secrets and tips and tricks. And,
wow.
And they were quite funny, as in, when you look at their family pecking order, you know, you've he's got his pickup truck as number two in the pecking order, and then the smoker, and then there'll be the wife, and then there'll be the dog, and then there'll be the firstborn. You know, it's quite an unusual hierarchy in the household.
Oh, this is so funny. How many trips did you do to Texas?
Oh, jeez. Somewhere between 80 and 110.
So it was all related to your business? You had to do
it? It was all with oil and gas.
Mm, awesome.
I've spent the better part of my career in the oil and gas industry all over the globe. The last 10 years of it, I've spent literally commuting backwards and forwards to Houston, Texas.
So being an engineer, did it help you with the creating the production line and things like that?
It did. We were able to put a flow process and a work process together that really worked for us. And we were able to make sure that the engineering requirements, i.e. the smokers, how they function, how the machinery functions, actually work for what we wanted to do.
Wow, you clever guys. Do you have any hobbies? Except cooking.
Car racing.
Car racing?
Yeah, done a bit of that. Me and Jerynn, we were running a Mini Cooper for a number of years, just, you know, with the Taranaki Car Club here, doing street circuits and...
I presume that it should be American cars, but no, you said that it was Mini.
Cheap to fix and cheap to run. Let's put it this way, my talents behind the wheel were not as good as the talents that were in my head. So, having more power was meant I was just going to break it faster. So having a Mini was probably quite apt.
Interestingly, Mini is the only car in the world that has higher reselling value than any other car. Any other car devalue? And this one, the Mini, increased the value because there are a number of collectors, and I knew several, and they all were investing into Minis rather than... So when you're saying that you're going to wreck it, don't wreck it that fast, maybe you'll get some profit.
We don't want to wreck it. We actually got quite good. We'd finish a day, because they're only a one-day event. We'd finish the day and we'd come home, and all we had to do with the car was give it a wash. Admittedly, we didn't finish first, but we didn't have to fix anything either. We didn't end it, so that was always good.
Oh, that's great. So just back to food, because that's our favourite topic. You talked about your development process. What flavours, what spices are you using in your flavour profile?
We're using basically three different types of pepper and a little bit of chilli. Just enough to let you know that there's some spice there, but not enough to actually burn your mouth. We want people to get a little bit of the taste, but not overpower it.
Right. So just chilli and pepper?
Basically, yeah. Mm. There's a little bit of salt in there, and not much else.
And a lot of smoky flavour.
Oh, yeah. well, Texas barbecue should be a balance between, you should be able to taste the meat, the smoke, and the seasoning. If you can taste all the seasoning and nothing else, you've got it wrong. If you can't taste the meat, you've got it wrong. If all you can taste is smoke, you've got it wrong. So it's quite a delicate balance, and we think we've got it about right.
Excellent. Well, I think it's time that we had a little bit of a music break. So obviously you are a fan of the 80s, because we've got Romeo and Juliet.
Is it on?
Sorry if I'm waffling.
No, you are so brilliant. You're so interesting. You have this background which you turned into something that, you know, corporate background in engineering, and you turned it into something that is meaningful for you. This is amazing. Yeah. We all love them. Good stories, and we have so many personalities. Virginia, who was interviewing you last year, she's one of the hosts here. Yeah, so it's actually quite cool to be.
She's awesome.
Yeah. Virginia can make a story out of a dead fly. She's I'm a big fan of her. She's amazing. She inspires so many people. She started so many initiatives. She's a really good journalist. And I mean, the whole most of them is based on personalities. Most of the people there are quite interesting personalities. They have some side projects, and people whom I invite as my co-hosts were also interesting personalities, like Jeff.
Well, so hopping out of what I was doing with Olena district was really good. I was spending a huge amount of time a year away from home. I've been in helicopters going to work and I've got bullet holes in them. And, you know, some of the places they put oil and gas plants is in some very remote locations. With warring tribes and fractions.
Yeah.
So you go to work with armed security, having to look after you to go to work and come home again.
It's nicer when it's
time,
yeah. It is quite sort of an enduring job and it takes a lot of effort. My husband works in the oil industry, but he doesn't have to travel. He works inside Taranaki. It's really interesting. It has a lot of stigma, but I do not support that. I think that we, especially in New Zealand, we do it right, and make the most out of the use of all the resources. So I think that New Zealand has something to praise itself for, and Taranaki, strangely, it's up at the frontier. There are so many different innovations in the field of technology and oil, and it gives a lot of people inspiration. It gives a lot of people food on the plate. And, yeah.
Well, I've hopped off the helicopter on all platforms around the globe and walked down the stairs into the Halley Admin, and here's a bloke from Hara Taranaki or the ex-New Plymouth, or some of the moonbeam from England. Everywhere I've been around the globe, Egypt, all the way up through the Middle East, I keep running into people from New Plymouth, straight from Hara.
Now, we spent New Year's 2000 in Times Square, and right to our left was someone from New Plymouth, New Zealand. Millions of people in there.
Interesting. So, are you originally from Taranaki?
Yeah.
Mm. So, local, returned back to the roots after some time.
Never really left.
Jerynn, how did you find Taranaki? This is simple.
I love Taranaki. We met because I was having a vacation in Christchurch, because my sister and brother-in-law lives in Christchurch. Mm. That's where we met.
Mm. Oh, awesome.
And Taranaki is, I think, better than Christchurch. But it's just for me.
Because
it's so quiet, so peaceful.
Yeah.
People are friendly.
As an immigrant myself, I experience a lot of this cross-cultural things and how we all adapt. And it's never easy. Everyone has a personal story, even if people immigrate with a family. The story, the travel of each member is different because they all go through their personal things to adapt and find their place. So it's actually quite interesting. It's wonderful that you're involved in something family and you kind of create your own place for it.
Hello, hungry, I'm Jeff.
Well, the whole idea of Texas barbecue is to build is to help build a retirement for the total family, not. You know, this is for Shiloh and Jerynn and Matthew Zim, and you know, help put something together for everyone, something that's free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Awesome. I'm going to cut this short soon.
You must be a popular member in your extended family, producing such delicious meat for everybody.
They're all coming around tonight to taste test the new ribs.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow. We're witnessing new product being born.
I can't imagine why you and your extended family wouldn't buy this from the supermarket. It's delicious.
It is. I really like it. It's a hobby gone way out of control.
Right, guys, I'm cutting it short. Welcome back to Taranaki Foodies with Olena Williams, Jeff Poole, Nathan Griffiths, and of course our guests, Ash and Jerynn Peters. So, what did you do before the barbecue foods? We already had a little bit of a discussion, especially you, Jerynn. We know that you were in the oil industry.
Well, my background, I'm a nurse and a teacher in the Philippines.
Oh, wow, it's
then
perfect.
Then we got married, I'm a stay-at-home wife.
Mm.
And then, she's working for in an oil and gas company.
Oh, that's lovely. So one of the most exciting times of Taranaki Foodies at the moment is food tasting. So our team is going to try your food in real life and give you an honest review on the show. What do they think about it? So tell us what's on the menu today. And you guys can start trying.
Well, we've got some slow smoked and cooked beef brisket and pork belly that's been smoked and cooked for periods up to 20 hours there. And we've got some of our smoked butter and smoked cheese, which is traditionally smoked. It's not artificially flavoured. We actually put it in a smoker and smoke it for a full 3 hours to get that real lovely flavour. But most importantly, which I can see is dwindled in size now, was a pile of pork baby back ribs, which are going to be launched to market next week and introduced to Foodstuffs Countdown and the markets. And we're going to bring some to New World and New Plymouth on the one-way system. And these are true smoked and cooked pork rib, not boiled, covered in sauce.
So how did you pitch it for the supermarket? Did you just bring a platter?
we'll send them a Red Cross package and a little cover letter and a business card. And
since then, they were so happy to, because it's obviously such a good product, right?
Yeah.
So my team members are digging their teeth into the delicious smokiness. I'm talking. So I would like to ask you a question, which always worried me, because there is a barbecue and there is a barbecue. So what is the ideal side for a Texas barbecue party?
Oh, ideal side. For me, that's bread and butter.
Wow.
For a lot of other people, what goes really well with it is a real good mac and cheese that's got some, say, jalapeno pepper in it.
Mm.
And the cheese really dials down the jalapeno, so you can actually have quite a bit of it and really get that lovely flavour comes from. That actually goes really well with it.
Is American cheese any good?
Some of it's okay. There's some cheeses they have over there we haven't got here that I'd love to get my hands on. But
So internet gives completely different opinions on what is the best side dish. For you it's bread and butter, and there is some traditional mac and cheese things. Some people amended, some do the corn fritters, some do the fried okra.
Yeah.
So Jerynn, you are bringing your 100% Asian flavor. What do you do as a side
dish? Rice.
Rice.
I use our pork belly with my fried rice.
Oh wow.
So it's really nice. Mm.
So we make a Filipino / Texas.
Yes.
Barbecue adobo.
Texapino.
That's really interesting. This is the name of a new product, isn't it?
I think I'd love this with a really good coleslaw.
Yeah.
That'd be a great accompaniment.
Or corn in a cob.
That's a real Kiwi favourite.
Corn in a cob. I probably would enjoy it. Corn in a cob. Russians eat everything with potatoes.
Yeah.
And our salads are quite rich, so salads probably will go with a small barbecue meat. But you know, after Cold War, when we were enemies with anything American, and since then it's finished, people opposite, they're embracing what they didn't know. So they'll probably go for chips rather than potatoes. Yeah. So have you ever tried to smoke something not meat, like carrot, broccoli, aubergine?
Yeah, we've smoked a lot of things actually. A couple that really stand out is for my wife and her friends, I'll do smoked mushrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And
is it real mushrooms or magic mushrooms?
No, real mushrooms. And sometimes I'll wrap them in a little bit of streaky bacon, and as soon as you put those on the table, you'll turn around and they're just gone. And another one that everyone seems to really love is actually smoked eggs.
Mm-hmm. Oh wow,
yeah.
Smoked eggs, that's interesting and very innovative.
They are just absolutely divine.
Mm. So when I tried your brisket, because I bought it some time ago and I tried it actually non-heated, you said that it's necessary to put it in a heat for a while to develop the taste better. But I tried it cold, and when I tried it, I was thinking of the Japanese glaze, like a mirin, miso, all this fish soy sauce and things like that. So for me, this is kind of a matching. Have you ever tried that?
Yeah, we have. We've tried a number of different sauces and glazes and that, and some of them work really well. It's all, again, it's personal taste.
That's true.
My favourite is, I always recommend everyone heat the meat up. You know, warm it up in the pack, 30 seconds in a microwave, in the packet open.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is that heat, the aromatics of the smoke and the spices really comes out. It activates the peppers. And it's really nice cold, but absolutely amazing warm.
Oh, wow. Mm. So MasterChef judges say that everything about food is about the balance. But all Texan in the world is all about excess. What's your view about it?
Well, having been in America a lot, and let's put it this way, if I went out for dinner, I'd order the kiddies meal or the elderly meal, because
yeah.
I couldn't just...
Or we'll just share in one meal.
couldn't eat the standard size serving. So yes, their food can be excessive. We've tried very much with this to keep it really well balanced so that it's a good healthy meal that's not full of salt and preservatives and other rubbish that we don't need to be eating.
Absolutely. I think my team is ready to give a review. We'll start with.
Thumbs up.
There you go. What do you think?
Okay, well, that brisket, it was oily, which you told me that's the way it's supposed to be. You said the oil was released during the cooking process and that oil was
supposed to be there.
Now, that really adds a lot for me. And this the light coloured one,
the pork,
was enjoyable to eat because of its texture, and the taste was amazing too. Obviously, all the smoke is there as well.
Mm. Yeah, I'm loving the warmth that's coming through from the smoky flavour. The crust on the brisket, ribs. On the ribs, yeah, just so much flavour. I completely got everything off the bone that I possibly could. And it's leaving that lovely warmth of the pepperiness and that little hint of spice in my mouth. I've still got that in there. I also tried the smoked butter, which you can really feel that kick of the smoke in there. And it would be a great accompaniment with just some lovely mashed potato and put some big knobs of that in it, or even through some mushrooms and some, that nice smoked butter on your corn. So many things. Yeah, so many things you could do with it.
My favourite was the pork because of its texture. But what I noticed about the brisket is all the elements seemed to be there. It just had it all. Like, there was the oil, a little bit of oil on it, and it had the crispiness, the tenderness of the meat was there, the taste was great. I'd never tried a meat with such a subtle spicy flavour. And I'm going to use a word that's very unpopular, but I think it was perfect.
I'm going to give you a 10 out of 10. Hang, I'm going to give you 11 out of 10, because I'm from Texas.
And guess what? Normally I don't really try the show, but I did today. And this was absolutely wonderful. I tried the pork, I tried the brisket, and also I tried the ribs. And everything was slightly different, but it's very recognizable, and I would say that it's very European. I couldn't taste Texas, but I could taste the May night, May celebration in Ukraine, somewhere where people get together, have lots of drinks, have some songs, and having basically a good time. So thank you for bringing back the memories.
I think one of the things that's probably slightly different from a lot of commercial products is you're getting that really true smoky flavour, and a lot of the stuff that you might buy off the shelf, you're not getting that level of intensity, are you?
Mm.
So well done.
Thank you.
So when someone decides to organise true Texas barbecue, what sort of entertainment do they normally put into it? Is it any cowboy poetry or country music, or maybe...
When you're in Texas, there's a lot of country music going. Some of the locals, like, you'll go and have a beer at their place and they're cooking up Texas barbecue for dinner, and it's quite an event. It's not just turn up, have dinner, have a couple of beers and leave. It starts long before the meat comes out of the smoker and finishes long after. And after they've had a beer or two, they'll quite often get some of their local country music out. And then the songs come out like deep in the heart of Texas. And they get up and they cheer and they carry on. It's actually really cool to be involved in that and to see just a group of people suddenly get up from around a table and start dancing to songs like Deep in the Heart of Texas.
So we normally give our guests the right to choose music for the show. So you have chosen three pieces of music and we're coming to the end of the show. Can you tell us something about the last piece of music we're going to play soon, which is... 1,000 Years and by Christina Perry. What's the significance?
This is one of my wife's favourite songs. Mm-hmm. It was chosen for her.
Why?
Because I love her.
She must be a Twilight fan, is she?
Mm-hmm. Oh, not really.
Frozen. Frozen fan. She loves the movie Frozen.
Come on, let it go.
Right, we are ready for the music. This was so wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing your experience and bringing I'm bringing your wife because originally she was against it, but you are such
I'm always behind the camera, behind the scene.
And this is right, because we have a proverb in Russia that man is the head and female is the neck. So when neck turns, that's where the head is looking. So we are important success of their lives because we can make their life miserable or we can make their life quite comfortable.
That's
so
true.
To me, you're all part of the you're a team. You're all working together for a common thing. You know, we all bring different strengths to the to what we're doing. And if it wasn't for the balance of the strengths she brings and what I bring, you wouldn't achieve those successes.
And obviously it works well because everyone is occupied, you know, family is occupied, everyone's happy, you're doing meaningful things, you're doing what you love. This is wonderful.
This is a lot of fun.
Salamat po.
Awesome. So after this music, I'll just say a few words saying that we're kind of wrapping up and then we will have some selfies. And this will be the end. So I hope I didn't hold you for too long.
Thank
you. 40 minutes. You are all right with the time, Jeff? You're not hurrying anywhere?
No,
no, that's great.
I've been up the mountain before.
Oh, have you gone to the mountain today? Wow, that's
why
really...
I'm so hungry.
10 hours, or how long did it take?
No, we just tried and walked, did a little walk.
That's all right. Thank you very much for agreeing to come because Warwick is away. Warwick is my co-host. He's a broadcaster, the most of them, and he's a big foodie. He really likes Asian food. He likes some ramen. Yeah, but he's away today with his wife. So I'm so grateful to Jeff that he just fill in. Oh, lovely. This is a song for the twilight, right? And this is when they realize that they kind of love each other, although they have differences, like she is not vampire, basically. It's beautiful.
It's a real wedding, you know, popular as a wedding song.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. Did you play it at your wedding? What was your wedding like? Was it Filipino or New Zealand?
We got married twice in 1 week.
Once in the Philippines, and then at home. The Filipino was a quite traditional Filipino wedding.
Did you wear traditional outfits?
No.
It's more what Jerynn had sort of said, but I look smart, and so follow her advice.
Where are you from in the Philippines, Jerynn?
Sorry?
Where are you from in the Philippines?
Oh, Laguna, which is an hour away, 53 kilometers away from Manila.
Oh, okay.
So we're not too far from Manila.
I've been to Manila.
Oh. You've been everywhere in Asia, haven't you?
No, I need to go. And I went to Rojas.
City, down south.
You speak really good English. Where did you learn?
School.
Oh, wow. Obviously, there is a good education, but I noticed that a lot of countries put an emphasis on learning the second language.
That's our major instruction in school, English.
Yeah, pretty. How does it feel when your husband publicly chooses the song that will please you? I don't know.
She didn't know I picked this. This is all a surprise to him.
This is very sweet.
He didn't tell me anything about what's going to happen today. He just told me, oh, we have to bring some samples and make some patterns, and that's it.
And you are up for vegan. Yes, I have to do some more work. Yeah, I'll do the platter. Yeah. Interesting. I have a lot of interest in ethnic cooking because I have classes and I blog about food a lot. So it was a period of time that I did a lot of free food all the time. Like people said, hey, for a little bit of exposure, do you want to do this? And it was like a year and I was just so exhausted after thinking, and no one paid me for this. And it was like, come on, I have to stop that because it's not, never going to stop. So it was really funny. Yeah, but it's all part of the important part. So, welcome back to Taranaki Foodies. Our guests this afternoon, Ash and Jerynn Peters from Texas Barbecue Foods. Tune into 100.4 FM every Saturday at 4 p.m. Remember, there is a live recording of this interview online on Taranaki Foodies group page on Facebook. Thank you very much for Jeff Poole for being my co-host today. Thank you, Nathan, for being the videographer, and thank you, our wonderful guests, for being with us and sharing your stories.
It's a pleasure. We really We feel quite humble being here.
Meet all of you next Saturday on Airwaves. Bye-bye, my wonderful gourmetarians.